We all, at one time or another, I shouldn't say this. Most of us, maybe all of us, at one time or another, have used a GPS, right? How many of you have ever used a GPS? How many of you had to use it to get here this morning? No? Okay, that's good. GPS. I would venture to say that a lot of people who have used it like it, right? I mean, here's this thing that you can get directions to literally anywhere in the world, right? Have you ever played with your GPS? Like, put in some way, like, place clear across the world, and it says, you know, like a 15-day drive kind of thing it mentions or something like that. Or if you put it on walk, it's really funny because, you know, it'll say, like, don't even try, you'll die before you get there kind of thing or something. I don't know. But it's fun to put in those foreign countries because it has these really long distances and stuff. But we like it, and it gives us directions to anywhere. And the thing is, we have it right on our phones, right? Most of us, unless you're still really rocking the flip phone, then you probably don't have GPS on that. But in any case, it gives us directions to any place. And in a sense, it makes the joke that men won't stop for directions kind of obsolete, ladies. I'm sorry. You know? Because we don't have to, right? If we're lost, we just type in, you know, like the nearest crossroads, and it picks us up and gives us directions to wherever we need to go. So you know GPS was invented by a man, right? It had to be. Anyway, GPS stands for Global Positioning System, and it works with satellites, right? That there are receivers on the ground, and they use radar to connect with satellites that are orbiting the Earth. There are about 30 of these satellites orbiting the Earth. Radar detects where they are and where they're supposed to be. Okay? A receiver is found in your phone, or if you still use one of those Garmin's or TomTom devices, it's found in one of those. And what that receiver is doing is it is constantly listening for signals from those satellites. And the receiver then calculates how far away it is from the satellite. Okay, so your phone with that receiver is calculating how far away it is from those satellites. Once it has done that with four or more of the satellites, it knows exactly where you are. And depending on how strong the receiver is, it can pinpoint your location to within inches of where you are. Now, on the one hand, that's pretty cool, right? On the other hand, that's frightening, right? That someone out there could potentially know where you are to within inches. GPS works because you have something with you, in this case, your phone. It is looking up to find direction to lead you to a certain place, to help you get to your destination, the place that you long to get to or to be, and to prevent you from getting lost or to help you if you have already gotten lost. Our fifth and final key to unlocking Christmas is this idea of guidance for the lost. And to help us understand what is meant by that, we're going to look at the story of the wise men in the Christmas story. The wise men looked up into the night sky and they saw a star that God used as an ancient GPS system to guide them to the baby, to guide them to the king, to guide them to Jesus. The star was a fixed point that they focused on, that gave them guidance that they needed to find this baby that they longed to worship, to see, to be in the presence of. Now, if you're like me, you can't wait for this year to be over and are looking forward to a much better 2021. But perhaps you're also wondering, how did I even get to this point in 2020? And what is it that's going to enable me to survive and thrive in 2021? 21. Well, the story of the wise men help us to answer those questions. Because when we look at this story, when we look at those verses that we read, there are four W's that we can draw from them to help us as we seek to navigate in 2021, that help us to see that fixed point that we can focus on that will help us in the coming year. The first W is westward ho, right? In the song, westward leading. We're told in the story, the wise men came from the east. It means they came from a place east of Israel, east of Jerusalem, east of Bethlehem. Therefore, they headed west, right? The old saying, go west, young man. I think Michael W. Smith wrote a song, something like that, right? That's what they did. They went from the east to the west. Now, there's a lot of conjecture and thoughts about who the wise men were and where exactly they came from. Some believe the wise men were priests that were Medes and Persians. When we looked at Daniel in the summer, you'll remember that the statue that of the in the dream that Nebuchadnezzar had, right? It was the gold and the silver and the bronze and the iron and the clay and iron mixed, right? And those, Daniel said, those are representative of different kingdoms. The head of gold was Babylon, the one that was reigning at the time. But the next kingdom, the kingdom of silver, was the kingdom of the Medes and Persians that defeated Babylon. Some believe the wise men were priests from that kingdom. Others believe that they were descendants from the Babylonian priests and kings and magicians and sorcerers. Right, when you read through the book of Daniel, every time there's a dream, every time something happens to Nebuchadnezzar, he goes to his own men first, right? His own wise men. And it's always Daniel that comes to his rescue. Those guys are useless. They can't do anything, but yet he continues to go to them. Well, some think that these wise men in the Christmas story are descendants from them, from Babylon. Still others think that they were just intellectuals, learned men who studied astronomy, who studied prophecy. And so when they saw the star, they recognized it from prophecy, and they just set out to follow it to see where it would lead. Coming from the east, then, many have speculated that they came from the Arabian desert or from Saudi Arabia. Wherever they lived, wherever they came from, the fact is they understood there was a God who had reached down into our world. A God who had stepped off of his throne, who had given up, as Paul says, who had set aside all the beauty of heaven, all the things that were his by the fact that he was God, who set that aside and entered our world and came to us as king. And they followed God's direction to find that king, to get to the place they longed to get to see this baby that they had read about and understood was coming. And God gave them this star in the sky that if they would simply follow that, that God was speaking, God was directing, God was leading them through that star. And that if they simply followed, they would find the king that they longed for. Now, we don't know what kind of faith the wise men had. We don't know how deep their faith was. But we have to assume that there was some level of faith there. Okay, I mean, think about it. They traveled for months, maybe even years, right? Because we understand what we read in chapter 2 of Matthew to be maybe 2 years after the Christmas, after Jesus was born. So they traveled a long time. They did it on camels, right? I mean, you want to talk about some discomfort, right? Okay. They were hurting, I would imagine. So they traveled a long time. They traveled on camels. And they did it to see a baby. Through the desert to see a baby. They responded and relied on the direction of God because they knew God was speaking, that God had done something, that God was revealing something, that God was delivering on his promise, that there was something special about this child. As we seek guidance for how to live, I think this must be our attitude as well. To respond to God's call, whatever it is, and to go through whatever He wants us to. That we rely on Him to be our star in the sky, to be our GPS that will lead us to what He wants us to do. The second W is the Word of God. There are times in life when we really search for and desire to clearly hear God's Word, right? When we've got decisions to make, job decision, relationship decision, life decision, when we have issues to work through, when we're confused, when we don't know which way to go, it's really helpful when we, you know, hear God say, "Steve, do this," right? That would be very nice. And when we do have those moments, we should appreciate them and thank Him mightily for them, because they are extremely handy. In the story of the wise men, notice that God speaks kind of in that way. Because notice that the star doesn't lead them directly to Bethlehem. The star leads them to Jerusalem. The star doesn't lead them to Mary and Joseph and the baby. It doesn't directly lead them to Jesus. The star leads them to Herod and to his wise men and to the palace in Jerusalem. But when they get to Jerusalem, they're probably shocked at what was not happening in the city. Right? Think about it. They have traveled many, many months expecting to see the birth, or this baby that has been born, the birth of a king. Naturally, you would think in the capital city, in the major city of Jerusalem, if the king of the people who lived in Jerusalem had been born, there would be excitement. There would be celebrations. There would be a parade, right? Yay, Jesus flags flying, all that stuff. And so as they walk into the city, they see it business as usual. They see the sitting king, he doesn't even know where this new king is supposed to be born or that he has been born. All is quiet. Nothing like you would think if the king had been born there. No fanfare, no joy. And so they ask Herod, "Where is this newborn king?" And God answers them by his word. The prophecy in verse 6 is what Herod's wise men give them. They speak God's word to the wise men so that they know where the child is. God's word still proves true for us today. It still fulfills that same role today. God still speaks through this into our hearts and into our lives today. This book gives us wisdom and it gives us guidance. To anyone who needs it, to anyone who's seeking it, you can find it here. Now, can you find the answer to the question of, should I take this job or that job? No, it doesn't get specific like that. But it still gives you everything you need in order to make a godly decision and to live your life in such a way that reflects glory and honor back to Him. It gives guidance to those who are lost and looking for direction. So as we are about to embark on a new year, it is beneficial, it is helpful, it is necessary for us that we spend time here. Because when we spend time here, then all the stuff we do out here becomes a little bit easier. The third W is the worship of God. If you want to thrive in life, one of the best things you can do is to make sure the object of your worship is the correct one. Now, I said it that way for a reason. Because we all worship something. We worship a favorite sports team. We worship technology. We worship our family. We worship our phone. We worship our house or our car or our job. Or we worship ourselves. We all worship something. The question before us is, what is it that you are going to worship? What will you worship in the coming year? Notice the response of the wise men. In verse 11, after they get into the house, it says they bow down and they worshiped Jesus. Their first response, their only response at that moment, the appropriate response, once they were in the presence of Jesus, was to bow down on their knees in front of him and worship him. They were overwhelmed by Jesus. I wonder about myself sometimes. I wonder about us. Are we overwhelmed by Jesus? Or have we just become bored with Jesus? Are we in awe of this God who gave us God in the flesh to do for us what we couldn't do ourselves? Are we so overwhelmed with this Jesus who died for us, who came in this most poor of ways, this most ignored of ways? Are we so overwhelmed with him that when we're in his presence, all we can do is fall to our knees and worship him? Or has it become just so easy and so normal and so comfortable to say, yeah, Jesus, he's cool, but, you know, he's not really a factor in my life, because I got all these other things that are so important and so neat and so cool? Have we become bored with Jesus? I know that might seem crazy to say, but let's look at some of the evidence that maybe we have. Look at some of our churches. Look at our worship. Have we become bored with Jesus? The wise men's reaction should be our reaction. I'm reminded of something that Gary Smalley said one time when we were at a conference of his. Gary Smalley, he passed away a few years ago, I think. He's an author. He is a marriage and family counselor. You may have heard of him. You may have attended some of his events. But he was talking about the way a husband and wife, or a husband, should respond to his wife. And he said, a husband should do this whenever he sees his wife. Oh my goodness. I cannot believe that I get to be your husband. I cannot believe that you would choose to be my wife. They were so overwhelmed by being in the presence of our wife that we have this, almost our breath is taken away moment. Do we have that type of response with Jesus? Or has it become like maybe some of our marriages have, where we almost ignore each other rather than stand in awe of each other? Have we become bored with Jesus? If that's the way that we should respond to our spouse with, then how could we respond to Jesus with anything less? The fourth and final W is the way of God. Matthew ends his story by telling us that an angel or a spirit came to the wise men, told them to go back home by another route. Okay? Herod was trying to trick the wise men, right? He tells them, hey, go find this child and then come back and tell me, because I want to go worship him as well. Now, if he didn't have something, you know, evil in mind, why didn't he just go with them, right? But we know that he did have something evil in mind, because later we're told that he sends out an edict that all the male children 2 years of age and younger are to be killed. And so because of that, the angel doesn't want the wise men to tell Herod where the baby is, and so they go back by another route, is what the NIV says. The ESV says another way. You might have a translation that says another way. Well, we think that that phrase, another route or another way, is telling us that they just went home by different directions, right? That the GPS gave them three choices, they clicked on the second choice rather than the first choice, and so they went back another way. They took Route 7, not Route 6 this time, or you know, something like that. And they probably did. All right, I'm not denying that they went back a different way. I'm not saying that. But what I am saying is that the word that Matthew uses for that phrase, another way, another route, it can also mean changed life. That the wise men didn't just travel by a different route. They didn't just go a different road. They didn't just go a different path back home. They went home different people. They went home as different men. That their presence, that their being in the presence of Jesus changed them. They were different men when they walked out of that house than when they walked in the house. You've probably seen something like this in people that maybe you knew several years ago and you haven't seen them for a while, and then all of a sudden you run into them. And maybe at first you don't even recognize it's them, but then you're like, oh yeah, that's so-and-so, and then you talk for a minute, and then you leave, and you're like, wow, that person's really different, right? Sometimes that's a good different, sometimes that's a not-so-good different, but it's different. They've changed in some ways. Usually high school reunions are a good place for us to find situations like that. Same with the wise men. Being in the presence of God, heeding his direction, responding to his word, bowing down in the worship of him. It had an effect on them. And it should have an effect on us. It should change us. It should make us different people. I've seen in my own life and in the lives of others that so often when we say we want God to help us or that we need his guidance, really what we're saying is we want God to change to fit what we want. Right? That we have something in mind for how we want something to go or for what we want to receive, and we feel like maybe that's not God's will for us. And so when we ask for his help, really in the back of our mind is what we're saying is, God, you need to change your will to fit this because this is what I really want to do. And so you need to make this happen. And so often we're asking God to change when in reality, what the wise men tell us, what the wise men show us, is that God doesn't work that way. God doesn't bend to our beck and call. God doesn't change what's right and what's wrong to fit what we think it should be. He says, no, 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 you change, you bend, you break, you conform to what I have already established is right and is wrong, and that will never change. When we do that, when we act in that way, we find that God is actually fine. Actually, we see God is perfect, that he doesn't need to change. That we are the ones that do. I close with this. I was reminded of this verse this morning that helps as we think about navigating and guiding and living life in the way that God would want us to, fixing our eyes on that star and that fixed point. Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, submit to him. And he will make your paths straight. Let me close for us. Father God, thank you for the wise men who came seeking you, and when they found you, they were overwhelmed with Jesus, who listened to your word, who followed your direction, and who were changed as a result. My prayer, Lord, is that we would learn from them. That we would be open to where you're leading us. We would seek your direction through your word. That we would not be bored with Jesus. And if we are, Lord, remove that from us. Give us that excitement and that awe of who He is. But that we would worship Him. That all we could do in His presence is bow down before Him and lift Him up. And that we would let You do what You do within us. Changing us, shaping us, creating in us these new people who love You and seek to fulfill Your will each and every day. Give us Your guidance, Lord, as we live this life so often that in which we feel lost. Remind us of that fixed point in the sky. Remind us of the star. Remind us of Your presence that goes before us and directs our paths. In the name of Jesus, we pray.